Check, check. 1, 2, 3. Welcome and thank you for tuning in to our live Facebook service this morning. If you're online joining us, we thank you for joining us. If you're here, we thank you for joining us here too. One quick announcement, and then Miss Carla is going to make an announcement, and then I'm going to ask my lovely wife to open us up in prayer this morning. I just sprang that on her, so you know, I might have to do some smoothing over a little bit later. But anyway, I want to ask her to do that. And so this Wednesday night, we are having Bible study on Wednesday nights. The children's stuff is going on. The youth is going on back here. All that starts at 7, but we've had a couple people ask us if they could cook before service this Wednesday night and feed everybody at no charge. Here's the deal. If you come to eat, you got to stay for service. All right. So food will be ready: burgers, hot dogs, chips, dips, and an assortment of drinks for you to choose from. But that'll be, like I said, free of charge, and that'll be ready at 6. They're going to have it ready a little before 6. But you can come and begin to fix your plate at 6 o'clock. Parents, I would take advantage of this. It's a good transition. You don't have to go home and cook and come to church. Just go home and get the kids and come here. Amen? Amen. And then Miss Carla has one announcement that she wants to make. Nah. Amen. Thank you for that, Miss Carla. Sheree, would you open us up this morning? Amen. Would you stand and worship the Lord with us this morning? Might be a song or two that you're not super familiar with, but that's okay. We just want to worship the Lord. Just hang in there with us and give your praise to Him. Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring, and through the winter rain, beyond the horizon,
mercy for today. Faithful you have been, faithful you will be. You pledged yourself to me, and that's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. Your love is devoted, your love is devoted, like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. Faithful you have been, faithful you will be. You pledged yourself to me, and that's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. You father the orphans, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness, you're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt and rid of all her shame, and bound by her new name. And that's why I sing. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. You will be praised, and you will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised with angels and saints. We sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. Angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. For I sing, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips. You will be praised. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing, worthy are you, Lord. You will be praised. You will be praised. With angels and saints, we sing. ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips.
Hallelujah, God, we praise you today. We love you today, Lord Jesus, God. We ask you to hear our praise this morning. Not just hear it, Lord, but it would be satisfying to you. It would be pleasing to you, Lord Jesus. And we ask you to move in this worship service, God. We ask you to unbreak the bonds and the chains that people have been bound by for so many years, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We rebuke them in the name of Jesus. And we ask you to break them right now, God. Hallelujah. Jesus.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet.
Come on, sing it. You know it. Waiting for change.
Waiting for change to come. Knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet.
Your promise still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You'll never fail me yet. I know the night won't last. Your words will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again.
Jesus, you're still enough.
Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again.
Still stands.
Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You'll never fail me. Yeah.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move a mountain. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me yet. Hallelujah, Jesus. Has he ever failed you, church? I've seen you move. I've seen you move. You moved a mountain. I believe. I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. I believe. I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move. When you moved a mountain. I believe. I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Jesus.
Amen. Would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Jesus, we love you. Jesus, we worship you today, God. Hallelujah, Lord. Even though our worship is faulty, Lord, even though our worship, Lord, is the best that we can do, Lord Jesus, and you deserve so much more, Lord. So much more, and so much more than we can ever do, Lord Jesus. I ask that you would accept our worship today, Lord. I ask that you would hear our praises today, Lord God. I ask, Lord, that you would move and that you would have your way in my life and in this worship team's life, Lord Jesus, and our people's lives, Lord Jesus, our Sunday school, hallelujah, our youth, Lord Jesus, every person, every aspect of this church, Lord. Those that are at home that are not attending, Lord Jesus, for social distancing reasons, Lord, we don't leave them out. If you're a guest online, we ask the Lord to be blessed in your presence today, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. We ask you, Lord, hallelujah, to hear our praise one more time, Lord. Hallelujah, God. And do as you want to do in this service, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to high, and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice.
Come on, sing it, you know this.
How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. Oh, see how great is our God.
How great is our God.
How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great. How great is our God. Age to age, he stands. Time is in his hand, beginning and the end. Father, Spirit, and Son, the Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, sing. How great is our God? How great is our God? How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, see how great, how great is our God. Name above all names, you're the name above all names. You are worthy of our praise, and my heart will sing, how great is our God. Come on, sing it again. Name above all names. You're the name above all names, worthy of our praise, and my heart will sing, how great is our God. How great is our God? How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, see how great is our God? Come on, one more time without music. How great is our God? How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? Oh, see how great is our God.
If you believe he's great, would you worship him? Would you praise him? Just send up a praise right now to him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. We worship you, God. You are the author and the finisher of our faith, Lord Jesus. That means our faith begins with you and it ends with you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus, we love you. We love you, Lord Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, it's all about you. Jesus, hallelujah, God. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every part that is broken. Great are you, Lord. Sing it again. You give life. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Oh,
great are you, Lord. You give life, you give life. You are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath, it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Oh, great are you, Lord.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
One more time,
all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
If you believe it, sing it.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Oh, great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Oh, great are you, Lord.
All the earth, one more time.
All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, and these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
All
the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, and these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Jesus, we worship you today. Thank you, Lord God.
You know, I think we sometimes often forget that. And it's His breath in our lungs. And He's the one that gives us life. That every good thing that we get to enjoy each and every day is because of Him. You know, I know we're going through some hard times right now in this country and in our nation. But man, I see God's blessings each and every day. I mean, He is still faithful and He's still answering prayers and He's still just pouring out His love on us. And so often, you know, we don't even give Him half of what He deserves. And so this morning, we have a very unique opportunity to reach the throne room of heaven with our prayers and our praises. And I just want to encourage you to do that. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning for the needs in our church. I know we have several people who are sick, several families that are hurting. And so what I want to do, if you're online and you're viewing us this morning, I just want you just to comment your need in the comments. If you don't feel, you know, wanting to put that out there, you can just comment your name. And I'll go back and I'll look at Facebook after the service and I'll pray for your needs. I know several people in the church will do that. And if you're here this morning and you have a need that you want to be brought before the Lord, if you would just please just raise your hand. The Lord knows what it is. You know, he sees our heart. He sees what we need. And He's faithful to answer that. And so I want to pray for these needs this morning. And we're believing that God is more than capable to answer these prayers. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you so much, Lord, for being able to come to your house, Lord, and worshiping you, Lord. I thank you so much that no matter how much, God, that I have failed you in my life, Lord, you have never once failed me. Lord, you pursue me, Lord. You chase after me, Lord. You draw me unto you, Lord, each and every day, Father. And I thank you for that, Lord. I pray for these prayer requests that are mentioned this morning, Father God. I pray that you would just meet each and every need, Father God. If it's healing, Lord, I pray that you would provide healing, Lord. If it's strength, God, I pray that you would give them strength abundantly, Lord God. If it's a financial need, Lord God, I pray that you would, Lord, move mountains, Lord, yes, to reach the need, Father God. Lord, we know that you're capable, Lord. Yes. We know that you're a God that hears our prayers, Lord, and you're able to answer, Father. And I lift our nation and our country up to you right now, Father God. It says in your word, Lord, that if my people would humble themselves, Lord, you will heal our land, Father. And I pray that as American citizens, Lord, as Christians, Father God, that we would begin to humble ourselves, Lord, and come back to you, Lord, and that you would heal this land, Father God. I pray that you would remind us each and every day, God, of who you are, Lord, and what you are called to be in our lives, Father. And I pray this in your name. Yes. Amen and amen. And so we want to get ready to take up our morning tithe and offering. We want to remind you to be faithful with your giving. And so this morning what we want to do is I want to ask Brother Stan if he would walk around and take up the tithe and offering in here. And if you're online with us, we've made it very simple for you to give. There's a link in the comments. You can also text the word to give to 601-300-6140. Or you can mail a check to 719 J.C. Warren Road, Preston, Mississippi, 39354. And so I want to pray over our offering this morning and thank you so much for your faithfulness. Father God, we thank you, Lord, that you have blessed us, Lord. And because you've blessed us so much, Lord, we owe it to bless you, Father God, to bless your kingdom, Lord God, to do, Lord, what you've commanded us to do, Father. I pray this morning, Lord, that you would bless the gift and the giver, Father God, and that it would be used to further your kingdom. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Sometimes during our offering times, we introduce some new stuff to you, and you've probably heard this on the radio, but it's new for us to do in worship. And so I ask you not just to listen to it, but would you just sing it with us if you know it and worship the Lord. You unravel me. Sorry about that. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song
of deliverance to my end, until all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me. Your love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood throws through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Amen. Aren't you glad that you're no longer a slave to fear? Amen. Amen. That song had me feared. Sometimes when you're singing, or at least for me, what I know to be the right thing to sing didn't always come out. So I apologize. I know that was a little awkward. But it's worship nevertheless. Amen. Amen. If you'll open your Bibles with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 25. I want to share with you this morning some scripture concerning the last days, concerning what we are to be doing, what we know to be doing while we are waiting for Jesus to come back. He gives us some warnings through parables, and I want us to read one of those parables this week, and I want us to break that down and chew on a little bit, and next week, if the Lord allows, the way I feel in my spirit, we'll do another one about the same thing. And it's important for us as Christians to know that the Lord is coming back. It's important for us not just to know it, but to believe that the Lord is coming back. And so I want to read this scripture to you, Matthew chapter 25, starting with verse 14. And you can stand with me if you want to. And we'll go through. It's important for me to get there first. We'll go through verse 30. And so this is one that you've read many times, is the parable of the talents, but let's read it together. Again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents of money, to another 2 talents, and another 1 talent, each according to his own ability. And then he went on his journey. And the man who had received the 5 talents went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 more. So also the one with 2 talents gained 2 more. But the man who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received the 5 talents brought the other 5. Master, he said to you, you entrusted me with 5 talents, and see, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. The man with 2 talents also came. And master, he said, you entrusted me with 2 talents. See, I have gained 2 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things, and I will put you in charge of many things. So come and share in your master's happiness. The man who had received the 1 talent came and said, master, I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you had not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. And his master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown, and gathered where I do not scatter seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10 talents. For everyone who has will be given more, and he will have an abundance. For whoever does not have, even what he has will be taken from him, and will throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Lord, we worship you today. And what we're about to do is break your word apart, Lord, as you have given it to us, Lord. And I pray that you would help us to understand what we're about to hear. I pray that if it's offensive, Lord, that we would not be so offended that we can't make the application and make the changes that we need in our lives, God. And again, I also always pray, Lord, that you would only let me say the things that you want me to say, nothing more and nothing less. In your name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated this morning. Matthew's gospel devotes two full chapters to the subject of the second coming of Christ. So how does Jesus prepare his followers for the day of his return? He tells them stories, right? The Bible calls them parables, but they really feel like to us more like stories, or to me more like stories. And so we can read Jesus' words regarding his return in the book of Matthew, and also in the other Gospels, but we're concentrating on the book of Matthew's, and those is chapter 24 and 25. And so in this portion of Scripture, he's giving solemn warnings about the last days. We've always heard, we must understand that in these last days, there will be perilous times. The days before his return will be without precedent. They'll be filled with danger, and they'll be filled with woe. You remember we've read that word in the book of the Bible all over the place, and woe means you better stop and you better pay attention to what's happening. You better understand what the Lord is trying to say to you. And he gives us these scriptures in these last days for us to pay attention and to kind of say, whoa, you know, take a step back, stop, and let's make sure that you're where you're supposed to be and what you got what you're supposed to have ready. These stories are well known. Some of the other stories about the second coming are the wise and the foolish virgins, the parable of the sheep and the goats, and this one that we have just read. And so as we break this down this morning, I want you to put yourself in the situation of this scripture. Put yourself in the situation of these servants that were entrusted things, talents, money, whatever it is that God may have entrusted you with to do for his kingdom. And I want you to put yourself in those situations this morning. So let's just take a moment and recap the story. A man going on a journey gives portions of his estate to three servants who each make choices regarding what to do with their master's money, right? He entrusted them with it, and he wanted some return on it. And so we know that the first and the second one went out, put it to work, and they gave a return on it. And we know that the third man buried it. He hid it, so to speak, because he knew that his master was a hard man and that he was reaping harvests where he didn't sow those seeds necessarily. So he was scared to lose it, is what he was saying. He was scared to do anything with it, and so he buried it. Everything that we have, I want you to understand that everything that we have, 25 verse 14, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his property to them. And so some things that we need to understand about this story is that, first thing, everything that we have has been given to us by God. Everything that you have has been given to you by God. Everything I have, all right? The car, maybe you went to the dealership and got the car. I get that. But who provided you with the job to provide you with the money to be able to pay for the car? That's right. And you might say, well, Pastor Ryan, I went out and got that job on my own. I went to school and got an education, or I went to a trade school and I did this and I did that. That's great. But who gave you the ability to learn all that stuff? We need to understand that everything traces back to God. All the good things in our life traces back to God. And all the bad things in our life trace back to us. The lack of God in us. Okay? So as we're going through this morning, we need to get it straight that everything we have is given to us by God. Do we see ourselves now as stewards or owners? Because there's a difference, right? Isn't it? There's a difference. You go to the bank and you borrow money for a car, a vehicle, a boat, a camper, whatever it is. We say it's ours, but it's really the bank's. We're stewards of that. We're stewards of that. The job that we have, we are stewards of the job that we have. I've heard people say, well, they pay me like a slave. I'm going to, you know, they don't pay me enough. I'm going to give them what they pay me. I'm going to give them what a good day's work is what I feel like should be, you know, what they pay me. If they're going to pay me more, I'll work harder. That's not the attitude. That's not what God intended for us to, the way he intended for us to look at that. He gave us that job. And I've said this over and over and over. In Colossians 3, chapter 3, it says, whatever you do in word or deed, do it as unto the Lord. Are you working at that job as unto the Lord, even though you're not getting the wage that you feel like you are earning? Some of us are blessed beyond measure. Some of us have good paying jobs and we don't come close to earning our salary, you know? And some of us are on the opposite end of the spectrum. But whatever end you're on, you have to realize that that is a gift to you by God. Be a good steward of it. You want a better paying job? Be a good steward of what he's given you to do and then watch him work in your favor. Don't try to climb the ladder yourself. Let the ladder be climbed by him and let him pull you up. That was better. I should have got more response off of that statement. Let the Lord climb the ladder and then let him pull you up. Let him bring you with him. A steward lives for the day that he will return his master's goods to him. Doesn't he? Are you living for the day when the Lord comes and you can say, stand before him and say, Lord, I did this in your name. I did this in your name. And I'm going to talk about this a little bit later on in the message, but don't get too crazy, because there will be those that stand in front of him and say, Lord, I cast out demons in your name. I prophesied in your name. I did this in your name. I did that in your name. And he's still going to look at them and say, but I never knew you. I think I said this last week, but I want it to be etched in your mind and in your spirit. It doesn't matter if you know the Lord or not. It matters if he knows you. If he knows you. I want you to understand me this morning. My heart is grievous this morning for the amount of people that think they have a relationship with God and they don't have a clue that they're going to hell. They think they have it all together. They've recited a prayer that somebody led them in, and that's good. That's good. But you can't leave it down there. There's more to it than that. And so we think that we're in a straight and narrow path, but we're not always in that straight and narrow path. We think we're good with God, but we're not always actually good with God. Here's how you can tell. Is he asking you to do something you're not doing? That's a check mark against you. It is. Are you paying your tithes? Amen. Even though you're not here, are you paying your tithe? When you go on vacation, do you use that tithe money to be part of your vacation money and never pay it to the church? Or do you go ahead and set it aside and send it in? There's really no excuse now, because we got online giving and text to pay. You can't say, well, I wasn't there. I forgot to give it since I wasn't there. If you're not paying your tithe and you're not doing it faithfully, that's another check mark. My toes are hurting. Are yours? What God has entrusted us with, we are overseers over. And how we choose to use that, whether it's money, a gifting, a talent, whatever it is, whatever he's given you to serve, whatever that capacity is, if you're not using it to the fullest, if you're not going out and making return on it, then you're not being pleasing to him. Pastor Ryan, you're being mean this morning. I am. And I hope we can all still be friends. But I didn't come here to be your friend. I came here to tell you about Jesus. I come here to tell you boundaries. I come here to tell you that what you think sin is not necessarily what God thinks sin is. what you think is okay, how you think is that you're able to get by with, is not okay necessarily with God. So I come here to challenge you to get on your knees. I come in here to challenge you to get in this Word of God and seek it out for yourself. I come here to challenge you to tune in online and listen to what God has to say, whether it's from me or whoever else is standing up here ministering that day. I come here to tell you that Wednesday nights when we do Bible study, we're taking this thing verse by verse, section by section, and we're breaking it apart, and we're talking about it, and we're just being real. This is how we feel. Is this right? Is this wrong? What do you think? We're just dialoguing about that. That's how you learn. Another good thing that you have in your possession is church. And I get some of us are not coming right now because of social distancing. And, you know, that's fine. I'm not trying to beg you to come to church. But I am trying to beg you to get online when we do it online. And I am trying to beg you to put yourself in the situation to where you would be here in church. I'm trying to get you to put yourself in a situation so God can change your heart. And in return, you change your life. See, we want the benefits from God, but we don't want to give up the things it takes to keep the benefits. That's a problem. He has no problem giving us salvation. It's a free gift to us, but when we get that salvation, there are requirements to keep it. And we're not willing to do those requirements because they're hard. And this is not even what I'm supposed to be preaching today. But it's hard, and it needs to be said. God has different values than you do, than I do. We're human. We can't think like God unless we get in the presence of God and experience Him and understand the way that He talks to us. Well, God's not telling me to change anything. When's the last time you read the Bible and prayed about what He wanted you to change? When's the last time you got in this Word and you were convicted by what you read in here? And then you just ignore it, and we walk away from it. That's not a relationship with God. It's not. Husbands and wives, boyfriends, girlfriends, we've all fought before, haven't we? We've all had different ideas about the way it should go and what should be done. A lot of that is over discipline. A lot of that is over money. Guess what? Communication can work those things out. But if you don't communicate, you're going to be mad, and you're going to be mad, and it's going to fester, and it's going to simmer, and sooner or later, it's going to explode. And it might not do it right then, but the next time is just going to add to it. The next time is going to add to it. How do you keep a fire going? You keep adding logs to it. You keep adding fuel to it. The opposite, exactly the same with our relationship with God. How do you keep that fire burning? You keep adding wood. Sometimes, listen, have you ever been around a campfire? And I know if you've ever been around Joey Copeland, you've been around a campfire. Shout out Joey. He can burn stuff for weeks at a time. He can. God's given him a gift to do that. Here's the deal. After a fire burns down, there's still some ashes. There's still some coals. There's still some smoldering going on. And what I know from growing up and being in the Royal Ranger program is that in the morning when you wake up and that fire still got a little warmth to it and there's still a little smoke there, all you got to do is restoke it a little bit. Throw a little pine straw on it. Throw a little bit of leaves on it. Get that flame going and have your fire, your wood ready to get back on there. So it will catch back up. But listen to me, if you're down today, if you are trodden in your spirit today, if you are pressed, you are not crushed. The Bible says that I might be pressed, but I am not crushed because of the Spirit of God that lives in me. So today, all you got to do is throw a little bit of wood on the fire. That's all you got to do. Will you throw some wood on the fire today? Do it right now. In your mind, in your spirit, begin to put that first piece of wood on that fire. Yeah. And let me tell you something else. When you're starting that fire, you don't just throw a log like that. You use smaller stuff. This is for somebody today. When you are a newborn Christian and in your walk with God, you don't start out with a blaze and just put a big old log on it. You start out with the small stuff, the kindling, the stuff the size of toothpicks, the stuff the size of pencils next, the stuff the size of a finger next, and then you build your way up. That's how you grow and you mature in Christ. Yes. And when you get down and when you get to the bottom and you think your fire has gone out, that's exactly where you start back over. You throw the small stuff on there. God, I don't know how I even found myself in this position, but I don't want to be here anymore. That prayer is a small stick. Would you forgive me, God? That's another small stick. Let me tie this in for you today. If you don't keep your flame going, if you don't keep your walk with Christ going, when he does return, you will not be with him. When you stand before him, he's going to say, sorry, I never knew you. And you can say, but Lord, I got saved when I was 10 and 11 and 12. And I got baptized when I was 13. And I felt like the pastor held me down longer than he held everybody else down. And he might say, well, the pastor knew something. You can be saved 40 times and you can be baptized 40 times, but that's not going to get you to heaven. Getting saved is the beginning. Making a public declaration of your faith and baptism is a log or a stick. Getting baptized with the Holy Spirit, now we're getting into the meat of the fire. Surrendering to the call of God in your life, that's another stick. Teaching those babies back there that you feel like you want to pull your hair out every week when you want to come in here. I told you the story about one of my Sunday school teachers. She came to my daddy one day and she said, I want to quit. Your son makes me want to quit. I don't want to teach Sunday school anymore. But she was faithful to it. She was faithful. And now look at me today. I'm not perfect, but I'm in the will of God for my life. I'm in the will of God for my life. God is coming back. And he's coming back for a bride that's without spot or without wrinkle. Are you going to get spots and wrinkles? Absolutely. But when your clothes get dirty, don't you just throw them in the washing machine and get them clean so you can wear them again? Don't you take one of those Tide-to-go pins and... How many of you have ever been going to something fancy and you dressed up and you know, you got your good-looking clothes on, you got them pressed and start? I hate to wear a seatbelt because it creases my shirts. But I started wearing seatbelts because they made it against the law. Sometimes the things that you don't want to do, God's asking you to do. It took them making a law to get me to wear my seatbelt. But I'm safer now because of it. I'm safer now because of it. God's asking you to put a seatbelt on. He's asking you to quit living a reckless life. Quit driving down the road at 80 miles an hour, taking curves like they're not supposed to be taken, doing fishtails. He's asking you to quit living a reckless and abandoned life. You've given your life to him. You are bought with a price. He don't want that price to be for naught. So he's asking you to put a spiritual seatbelt on. I'm sorry if this is all over the place, but this is on my heart. My heart hurts for people that think they have it together and they have fooled themselves because they listen to the deception and the lie of Satan. That comes in every avenue. Listen to me, every avenue of your life, deception is trying to enter. It's so important that you get this out. you put this down? So important. The things that you watch, the things that you hear, the things that you participate in, the coarse talking, the filthy joking, the stuff that you see on Facebook and you secretly enjoy, secretly laugh at. You're supposed to be a Christian, so you can't share it, but you that made me laugh. I wish I had somebody I could share this with. That stuff's got to quit. It's got to quit. Because what people can see on the outside is that you have it all together. But what God can see on the inside is that you're far from having it together. It's time to check the inside and not the outside. If you had somebody coming over for dinner, would you rather the inside of your house be clean? Or would you rather the outside of them? What appearance do you want to give them? I know all you wives are saying, I want the outside and the inside to look good. But us guys are saying, the inside is good enough, okay? You ain't going to work me down today. My only day off. The important thing is what's on the inside. This is just a vessel. This is just the body that God gave us to communicate and to live this life in. What he's more concerned about is your heart, your soul, your spirit. That's what he's more concerned about. That's what he's more concerned about. And it's time that we realize that, because he's coming soon. He's coming soon. The end times, the signs leading to the end times. I've had so many conversations about this lately, and with good reason. But let me tell you this. God did not give us the signs to the end time for us to get scared and clam up and stay a hermit. He did not give us that for us to be fearful. He gave us that so that when we see the signs, we know that his coming is near, and we can rejoice in the fact that my Savior is almost here to get me. Y'all should be clapping. Our Savior is almost here to get us. And there's somebody in here inevitably saying, well, Pastor, he's been coming to get us for the last 2,000 years. He has. And that's why it says to be ready. Because we don't know the time, or the date, nor the hour, nor the second. What he says is be ready. Does that take sacrifice? Absolutely. Well, wouldn't it be easier just to know when he's coming? Well, yeah, it would be easier. But then the work that he has set aside for you to do, for me to do, wouldn't get done, because we would do whatever we wanted to do, and then we would get together right at the last minute. How would you feel? I think, I hate to even give him credit, but I think Ethan made a point one time about that would be like parents being gone on a trip. I did this. My parents used to go away to general counsel, and they'd stay gone 4 or 5 days. And then this is after we were a little older and we didn't have a babysitter anymore. But we knew that they were getting home on this day, and that it didn't matter what the house looked like the other 4 days. But before they got home, it had to be straight. Yard had to be cut, all that kind of stuff. Wouldn't that be just like what we would do? It would. We would let everything go, and we would have the pleasures and the spoils of life that we thought that we wanted, and then at the very end, we would get it all together. But the truth that hits us in the face is that if we're not all together doing what God wants us to do, then the people that he wants reached will not get reached. So you can't call everybody that you know on that last day, on that last hour, and say, hey, the Lord's coming in an hour, get ready. Hey, the Lord's coming in an hour, let me lead you in a plan of salvation. Hey, there's not enough time to do that. That's why we work until he comes. That's why we go out into the harvest field and we plant. We turn the soil over, we plant, we fertilize, we water it, we watch it grow. And then either somebody, ourselves or somebody else, will come along and reap the harvest, right? We got to work for the harvest. And what does the Bible say? The harvest is plentiful. It's there. People are ready to give their life to the Lord, but the workers are few. Why? Because you are sitting in your pew. You are not giving your heart to the Lord. I'm concluding myself. We are not giving ourselves to the Lord like we should be. Our hearts on the inside say something different from what the outside says. The outside says we got it all together because we come here to church once a week or once a month or twice a month. Or some of us come two or three times a week every time the door is open. Just because we're coming here, and even just because we're giving tithe, does not mean that our hearts on the inside reflect the goodness of God. You're saying, Pastor, you're blowing my mind this morning. I don't want to blow your mind. But I am wanting to challenge you in your spirit. Challenge you in your spirit. And guess what? It's going to take more than 5 minutes here or here or here or wherever you choose to pray. It's going to take more than one lap around your house for prayer. It's going to take more than one, you know, a lot of people in that kayak and they get on that kayak. And it's going to take more than one afternoon in that kayak to get where you're wanting to be. Put yourself in your prayer spot, however you communicate with God, and stay there. Stay there. And then go back and do it the next day. And then go back and do it the next day. And just because we're here on Sundays and we get two services and I preach a message, that don't mean you get that day off. Do it that day too. Do it every day. Get your house in order before the Lord comes back. Because he's coming back. We all have gifts that he's entrusted us with. And so for us today, it's important that we take those gifts and we work the harvest field with those gifts. Whatever talent he's given you, put it to work. Put it to work. Because if we don't ever work the fields, there'll never be a harvest to be had from the field. Does that make sense to you? Does that make sense to you? And then guess what? The end of the story says that those two that worked and that they had a return on their money, on his money, the master said what? Come and share in my happiness. Come and share in my happiness. What does that mean? Well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of heaven. Enter in. Don't be the one that buried the talent. Don't be that one. Stop being the one that buries the talent. Get out and use your talent. Because if you don't, you're going to stand before him and say, but Lord, I didn't want to mess up. I don't want to teach somebody something that was wrong. Because then I'll have to go back and apologize and tell them I was wrong. And that's just too much. I can't take that kind of pressure. It stresses me out. I have to carry a paper bag because I have an anxiety attack. I'm not making fun of people that have anxiety issues. What I'm trying to get a point across to you today is this, that you still have a requirement, being a child of God. Being a child of God. As far as what he gives you, that's up to him. But whatever he gives you, it's your job to work with that talent, with that gifting, with whatever it is. He might gift you financially. It's your job to gift others financially. It's your job to feel the move of the Spirit in your life and give to whatever it is. He might give you the gift of working with your hands. It's your job to help others. You see an old lady that don't have anybody anymore to take care of her house and to clean the things up around the house. And maybe you're blessed and you got this big old lawnmower and you can cut that grass in 5 minutes. If that's the talent that the Lord's given you, do it. Even if you don't know them. You see somebody hurting on the side of the road. Be led by the Spirit. If he tells you to stop, stop. If he tells you to keep on going, you don't have a good feeling, keep on going. But if he tells you to stop, stop. Because that's an appointed time for you. He's not going to put you in danger. Whatever he's given you, use it. Work for the kingdom of God. Because you don't want to stand in front of him that day and say, Lord, I did that. I did this, but I was scared to really do this, so I just kind of, I started, but it didn't work out well the first 2 weeks, so I he's going to have to say to you, you wicked servant, you didn't do nothing for me. And for those of us that know him, we know that we're supposed to work for him. We're supposed to be about the Father's business. And so I urge you today to be about the Father's business. Would you stand with me? In the book of Joel, the Old Testament prophets all referred to it as the great and glorious day of the Lord, the return of the Lord. The second coming is the great and glorious day of the Lord. And on his return, Jesus will look for those that he can invite into his joy. This is my joy. Well done. Come in. He's going to be looking for those people. You're going to have to stand before him one day and give an account of what you did with what he's given you. And I can promise you, you want to hear him say, well done. I can promise you, you're going to want to hear him say, enter in the joy of my kingdom. Because he's prepared a place for those who will not choose that. He prepared it for Satan and all his demons. But he's going to send you there, or you're going to send yourself there if you don't choose him. You are. And you can say, well, if he's supposed to be gracious and loving, he ought to let everybody in. Well, that's not the way it works. His graciousness and his lovingness came to you in the form of his son, and he gave his life to you. Now that you know that, you have to make a choice. His graciousness is that he gives you a choice. What's your choice? What is your choice today? What are you going to do with those giftings and those talents? So what's the lesson here today? What's the lesson from the third servant? We need to see that our view of God will determine the choices that we make in our life. Listen to me say that again. The way we view God is going to determine the choices that we make in our life spiritually. It's important that we view God in the right way. It's important that we view God in the right way. Do we see Christ as a hard man, like the third servant said? And do we think it's that he's unfair and unrealistic in the things that he wants us to do when he tells us to give this up or to leave these friends behind or to do this or to do that? Do we view those things as unrealistic and harsh? Or do we view them as an opportunity that is going to draw me closer to him? Closeness to God is what we want. Matthew 25:24. If we do that, it will cause us to live our fear, our current days in fear, and we'll have unprofitable results. And then you know what the unprofitable results from the third servant got him. Cast away. It got him cast away. The Apostle Paul understood the freedom that we can experience through the grace of God when he recounted these words. In 2 Corinthians 12:9, he says, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. And therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. So what? If you keep struggling, bring it to God. So what? If it's been the 40th time that you've done this in the last 2 weeks, when you come in here and you can say, I'm still struggling, but praise God, I'm getting better. I still have trouble with this, but my Lord is helping me. How we view life constitute our spirituality. It's important for us to view life right. In all these parables, the second coming, and each story contains a depth of teaching regarding how we can prepare for his return in our everyday choices. So the first choice that we look at today is, what are you doing with your talents? What are you doing with what God has equipped you with? Are you going out and working and bringing back returns? Even if it's not double, that's better than doing nothing. All he wants us to do is be faithful to him. Be a good steward of the talents that he's given us. So I need you to make a choice today. He needs you to make a choice today. Are you being a good steward? And if you're not, will you? Will you be a good steward? Listen, this is not a salvation message. We talked about salvation, and we talked about how important it is for us to have our life right. But this message is about doing what God has given you the talents to do, working for his kingdom. And so this is the first week of some choices that we're going to have to make. And I believe that this is building, and it's going to cause us to grow as a church. And that when all this COVID mess is over and we're able to reopen and do things like we've once done them, that we're going to be ready to go after the harvest field. That's what I believe. Would you bow your heads with me this morning? When Christ returns, he's going to look for those whom he can extend the invitation. Come share in my happiness. Come share in my happiness. And so today, assuming that you have your heart right and your life right, what are you doing with your talents? What are you doing with what God has given you the talent to do things with? It could be anything. I don't know what it is. But are you using them for the harvest? Are you using them for the harvest? If you're not, shame on you. If I'm not, shame on me. Shame on me. But that can all change today. And all you got to do is say, Lord, thank you for this message. Thank you for opening my eyes to the importance of me not doing what I want to do, but what you want me to do. Thank you for letting me see that you've given me talents to work for your kingdom. And I'm going to start. I'm going to do that. If that's you today, you hadn't been working, but you want to work, would you lift your hand up? Amen. 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 Anybody else want to lift your hand up and say, God, I haven't been doing it right, but I'm going to. I want to. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. Amen. Amen. I want to pray, and then we'll be dismissed. I want to remind you that we have prayer tonight at 6 o'clock. That's a good place to start. Good place to start. With every head bowed and every eye closed, Lord, these hands that were raised were a commitment to you. I realize that I need to be doing more. I realize some things as Pastor was speaking that you blessed me with, and I wouldn't have those things had you not blessed me with them. Lord, we have a responsibility to you to work for the kingdom until you return. And so I pray that you would help us to continue on that journey. Some of us start on that journey. Those of us who have already been working, I pray that you would help us to continue on that journey. For it'll be hard, it'll be tough. But Lord, with your strength, we can do it. With your power, we can break through those barriers, Lord. And so today I'm thankful for the leadership of the Holy Spirit to spin off of what originally was said for the message, God, but to also tie in the second coming, Lord. Because it's important that we work for your kingdom so that others can experience the gift that we have, that we've been afforded. And so today I pray that you would put into our minds a determination to work for your kingdom. That you would put into our hearts, Lord, a desperate plea for others to see the need to have salvation in their life, Lord. I pray that you would impart to us a commitment to pray, to see the harvest come to fruition, Lord. Until you return, that's what we'll do. We're committing ourselves to you as Koi Assembly of God, corporately and as individuals separately, Lord Jesus. We're committing ourselves to you to work for the kingdom, to see the harvest. In your name I pray. Amen and amen. Thank you for coming this morning. Thank you for joining us online. You may be dismissed. Don't forget about service at 6 tonight.